So let's take a look next at lesson number two, which we're going to call the stages of grooming. Now, researchers who have spent time talking to predators who have been caught have found patterns in their stories, patterns in their modus operandi, how they go about affecting their abuse. And researchers have tried to stratify and articulate a way of thinking about it, and there's a number of different models out there. One that you will frequently find is something called the stages of grooming. And this is where they've examined the big picture and determined that you can divide the activities that these predators take into different stages. One of the first stages is called the selection of their victim. There are a number of factors that go into who a predator may choose as a victim. So we're going to put the child center here because the child is the center of this particular thing. So how will a predator choose a victim? There are a number of different factors that they've been able to identify. In addition to things such as the appearance of the victim, more important in many instances are vulnerabilities that the child has. For example, children who are in a single parent household are considered more vulnerable. This is because they will have less adult supervision. On top of that, the family household is usually in greater need financially or in terms of support, and so there are more opportunities for some of the later stages of grooming that involve building trust. On top of that, single-parent families and families in more difficult financial situations may have more difficulties with the children in terms of prior instances of abuse or in terms of substance use or doing poorly in school or having other challenging issues which place the child in an insecure position where they may have low self-esteem or low confidence, or there may be a sort of psychological neediness that the child has or that the parent has, which makes them vulnerable to somebody who can come in and put all of the appearances of a caregiver, of a trusted confidant who can help them. Because where there is that need, then that's where somebody can step in and kind of be the hero figure. And that, so what are some ways that predators gain access to kids? So just so that we have a stand-in here, we're now going to rearrange things here. We've got our child, we've got our predator here. So he's chosen the victim, so now he's here, but that's not enough. In addition to victim selection, predators also have to gain access to their victim. Now, what does that mean? Well, we can look at it in two different ways. The first one is really just physical access. Now, I'm talking about abuses that happen and start in one-on-one things. There are other types of abuse that the access is actually digital, where they start their grooming through using texting or online messaging. But right now, we're just going to talk about physical access. And so that may be somebody who comes over to the house and helps when maybe a water heater breaks. It may be somebody that the mother turns to when there's a behavioral issue with the child. It may be somebody who has sought out a job that puts them in direct contact with children for other purposes. For example, teachers and coaches, these are professions that predators tend to seek out because it gives them physical access to children in a way that people don't think is unusual for a grown adult to be interacting with a child. If you're familiar with my channel, you know that we talk about ecclesiastical abuse and Mormonism quite a bit. And one of the things that Mormonism does is it provides access to men of vulnerable children. So this may be somebody who is struggling in a single parent household who needs to go to the bishop for welfare. The bishop sees that there's a need. Anyone that's familiar with Mormonism knows that bishops are given the role of providing for the spiritual development of the youth. And so everyone assumes that the bishop is going to spend extra time with kids in order to foster that development. So the second stage is gaining access to the potential victim. They may choose a profession. They may choose to be engaged in their community in order to gain that access. Whatever happens, however it takes place. The goal is to find reasons to be alone with the child, because that isolation is the window of opportunity that they have to affect their abuse. Now, there's a number of other aspects to this. This is just a superficial review of it. So let's go on to the next part of these stages of grooming, and that is what's called in some cases emotional recruiting. And this is an aspect of grooming which has multiple targets. This is where the predator uses methods to build trust with their victim. And it's a deceptive form of trust. And the only way you know that it's deceptive is because his motive is to have people let down their guards so that he can effect his abuse. I'm using he as the predator in this case and using kind of the statistically most likely scenarios, but there are instances of female predators and certainly instances of female victims rather than male victims. And there's a whole bunch of different scenarios, but we're just using these as stand-ins for the general case. So the predator will take any opportunity he can to befriend the child, and he may do this through learning about the child's interests, trying to be helpful in the life of the child if they have needs in school, school supplies, food, outings, activities. They may give the child gifts or just the gift of time and attention, particularly vulnerable kids who don't have male figures in their lives that are giving them that type of time or attention. Then it moves on to something like sharing secrets, special experiences or conversations that the predator may start to have with the victim that start to build a wall of separation between the predator and the victim and other caregivers in their family. Many times you might think, well, this raises a red flag, but one of the tasks that the predator undertakes in this phase of building trust is also building trust with the parent so that the parent doesn't get alarmed when he's spending extra time alone with the child. And so this will be done by creating opportunities for him to be alone that don't raise any red flags, things that people would have rational explanations for. Oh, well, he's the scoutmaster. They're going to go and scout out a new campground. So that would make sense that they go on a campout together. That may be an example of one in the past that people had normalized that we now understand is very dangerous, because those were windows of opportunities where abuse happened. They tend to portray themselves as non-threatening. They go out of their way to try to be as unassuming as possible, because this allows people to let their guard down. And in instances, for example, in religious settings or institutions like a church, part of getting people to trust them is to project the image of a righteous, trustworthy person. And so these people may give outstanding sacrament testimony. They project a spiritual vocabulary, which helps people let their guards down so that if they're seen to be with a child, people will rationalize it away because they already have a bias of trust for this individual. Once you have that trust built, then the predator now has more opportunities to be alone with the child. And that's where a next phase of the grooming happens. And that is something that researchers have considered a form of desensitization. And there can be two different types of desensitization. One of the first types that will happen is a psychological form of desensitization. And that's where the predator will begin to bring up sexual subjects in conversation in an attempt, first maybe accidentally or as a tangential part of their conversation, or maybe something that's not overtly sexual, but something that refers to anatomy or maybe a dirty joke. These are forms of psychological desensitization that inject sexual themes into the conversation that they may be having with the victim that they've targeted in an effort to break down barriers which would normally raise red flags in the mind of a child, or in many instances, the children are just too innocent and naive to understand that these are red flags and that these are conversations that are inappropriate and it should not be taking place with somebody in this type of setting. The forms of psychological desensitization that you may see in the community at large involve things like dirty jokes that we've talked about. But when you look at institutions such as churches, the psychological desensitization takes a whole other dynamic, because there is a whole suite of theological frameworks that deal with moral and sexual issues that the predator can use to start to inject sexual themes into the conversation. And this may be, in Mormonism, certainly talking about the law of chastity. And if you look at different religions, each of them will have different theological landscape that the people will draw on. So you won't see the exact same words used or the exact same themes, but you'll find, I think, particularly in religion, that issues of repentance and confession and guilt and shame get incorporated into this phase of psychological desensitization. The most tragic part is when these predators move on to physical desensitization. It may start out with a back rub. It may start out with, you know, maybe they had an injury during one of their one-on-one basketball sessions that just starts what seems to be an innocent form of touch, of physical touch at first, but the predator continues to apply pressure and advance those forms of touch in conjunction with the psychological desensitization and injection of sexual themes into their interactions, and soon that touch becomes in and of itself sexual. The other dynamic of these stages of grooming is that the predator is also using messages of shame, of fear, of isolation to compel the child to keep their secret. This is particularly difficult in the religious setting because there's already this notion in the air that confessions or interactions with a bishop are inherently confidential. And the idea that those conversations are secret is built into the system. So this is kind of a big overview of these phases of abuse.